Hello students, my name is Abhishek Sudhir and I am an assistant professor at the Jindal Global Law School. Welcome to the UGC's EPG Pathshala 4 on Civil and Political Rights and Module number 19, the Right to Privacy in the United States and United Kingdom. This module will deal with the development of the right to privacy in the US and the UK. These two countries have been selected for consideration as, much like in India, it has fallen to the judiciary in those countries to develop the right to privacy. Following these judicial pronouncements, a privacy law was finally enacted in the United States. This law will only be briefly considered. The module will also look at the right to privacy in the context of abortions and gay rights in the United States. As far as the United Kingdom is concerned, this module will look at the common law, i.e. the judge-made law development of the right and the impact of Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights on the right to privacy in the United Kingdom. The purpose of this module is twofold. First, to introduce students to the right to privacy in countries with a legal and constitutional culture similar to that of India's. And two, to give the students an overview of the development of the right to privacy in the US and the UK. Now let's start with the right to privacy in the US. Privacy is an emerging right. Therefore, a discussion of privacy is typically a list of examples or situations where the right has been recognized by the courts, instead of a simple definition, such as the right to a fair trial. Privacy can be discussed in two different contexts or directions: the nature of the right itself and the source of the right. The nature of the right is underlying that is the principle that each individual or citizen is entitled to privacy. The source of that right is, okay, the principle is you are entitled to privacy. What is the source of that principle? What is the source of that right? Well, the sources are case law, the statutes, and the Constitution. Now, William Prosser, one of the leading American scholars on the right to privacy, refers to four basic kinds or branches of privacy rights. And he refers to these four branches in the influential treaties, the second restatement on torts in the United States. Let's look at the first category. Prosser categorizes unreasonable intrusion upon the seclusion of another as a privacy right. Essentially, the state should not unreasonably intrude upon somebody else. Essentially. So he gives the example of a physical invasion of a person's home, right? You essentially barge into somebody's home when you don't have a right to barge into their home because that's their home. It's a private, it's their private domain, basically. So further examples are unwanted entry, looking into windows with binoculars or cameras, tapping telephones, searching, you know, a wallet, repeated and persistent telephone calls, obtaining financial data, even bank balance, without a person's consent. Therefore, you have a right to privacy, let's say, in your email address. You have a right to privacy as to, well, your residential address. You have a right to privacy as to your preferences, your web browser history, for example. What kind of websites you visit, basically. So, this is the first type of privacy right, which is unreasonable intrusion upon the seclusion of another individual's private domain, basically. The second is what you could probably say is a right to publicity, the appropriation of a person's name or likeness. So tomorrow, if you were to start, let us say, an NGO, or you were even to start a company, a commercial venture, and you were to call it Shah Rukh Khan Private Limited, Shah Rukh Khan would say, well, you're appropriating my name, you're appropriating my likeness. So that is my right. I have a right to my name or likeness, and I have a right to publicize my name and benefit from it commercially. So what are the successful assertions of this right? Well, they involve a defendant's use of a name on a product or a label or in advertising a product or a service, right? So similarly, like I said, it's the right of publicity. As a practical matter, celebrities in the United States generally sue under the right of publicity, while ordinary citizens sue under privacy. So in the US, as we'll see later, they draw a distinction between public figures and private citizens. So somebody like a George Clooney or a Brad Pitt will not perhaps be entitled to the same level of privacy under the law as, say, an ordinary citizen of the United States of America would be. But that doesn't mean that if you were to start a company called George Clooney Advertising Limited or something like that. You're essentially appropriating Clooney's name, and a person who comes across that name would say, oh, maybe you're associated with George Clooney, when in fact George Clooney is not associated with it in any way. You haven't taken his consent in the first place, and if you're commercially benefiting from it, you're essentially benefiting off George Clooney's name. So in the United States, Clooney would then sue under the right to publicity. So the third category is the publication of private facts. For example, income tax data, sexual relations, personal letters, family quarrels, medical treatment, photographs of a person in his or her home, or again, all without his or her consent. And the fourth category is publication that places a person in a false light, somewhat similar in defamation. Essentially, right? Successful defamation action requires that the information be false. Right? In a privacy action, the information is generally true, but the information created a false impression about the plaintiff. There wasn't enough care taken to consult the plaintiff. So only the second of these four rights, relating to the appropriation of a person's name or likeness, is widely accepted in the United States of America. The United States is not very big on protecting the right to privacy of celebrities, and therefore it compensates them by giving them a right of publicity. And it basically says, okay, if somebody is publishing private details about, say, Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie and their marriage, the courts are likely to sort of, well, look the other way. But if you are going to benefit off Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt's name in a commercial manner, the courts will step in and stop you from doing so. So the right to privacy in the US was first referred to as a right per se, and elaborated upon in an article by two Supreme Court justices, Warren and Brandeis. The article was titled The Right to Privacy and was published in the Harvard Law Review, and the article emphasized the right to be left alone. The right to be left alone is a very basic, rudimentary sort of characterization of the right to privacy. Now, in the context of increased media coverage of people's private lives, the right to be left alone sort of emerged. And the article written by Justices Warren and Brandeis is often credited with the introduction of the tort of invasion of privacy. For those of you who are not law students, essentially the tort of invasion of privacy basically means a tort is a wrong. It's a civil wrong that has been committed against you and it has caused some damage, right? So if somebody says something about you and that causes damage to your reputation and what they are saying is patently false, then that is defamatory, essentially, right? It's defamatory. So you have a right to sue them in a court of law, and therefore the name, the tort of defamation. There's also a tort of invasion of privacy. So if the government unreasonably and unlawfully, most importantly, invades your privacy in the United States, you could sue the government for the tort of invasion of privacy. A strand of the right to privacy in the US is the protection, right? The protection against invasions of the private sphere by the government. In the US, the courts have been very, very, very strict when it comes to invasions of the private sphere by the government. And the landmark case is the controversial case of Griswold versus Connecticut. The case of Griswold concerned a law made by the state of Connecticut. The state of Connecticut punished any person who used any drug, medicinal article or instrument for the purpose of preventing conception. So essentially, if you used a condom, right? When you use a condom, what are you doing? You're preventing conception, right? So the appellant Griswold ran a center at which information, instruction, and medical advice was given to married persons as to the means of preventing conception. So essentially, Planned Parenthood, as the clinic was called, right, was saying to people, okay, look, you've had two children. Here's how you can, well, not have any more children, to put it, you know, plain and simply. The United States, of course, given its, let's say, Christian grounding, it's not a Christian nation per se, but it's a nation that's made up of a majority of its citizens are Christians and devout Christians at that, and have always had an issue with abortion. Something like abortion is always in front and center of the national consciousness in the US. In fact, an issue like abortion essentially distinguishes individuals as far as parties are concerned. The Republican Party considered pro-life, as they say, which is that they're generally against abortion, if not absolutely against abortion, but certainly they come from a general presumption that abortion is bad and it's undesirable, and that sort of has a, well, mainly religious tinge to it. And then you have the Democrats, who are seen as pro-life, which are seen as pro-choice, right? So you have the Republicans who are pro-life, as they say, we want to preserve the life of the baby, and under any circumstances, except of course when there is a danger to the life of the mother, we don't want there to be an abortion, right? Whereas you have the Democrats, or the liberals as they're known as, or the left, or the left of center party in the US, which is considered pro-choice, which is they believe in the choice of a woman. It's a woman's body. She has a right to privacy, right? That's her body. And if she wants to get an abortion, that is completely her choice, right? So this was an issue in Griswold v. Connecticut, a law which essentially said, right, if you use any drug, medicinal article or instrument for the purpose of preventing conception, you will be punished. This was, of course, challenged, went right up to the Supreme Court. Griswold was prosecuted, and she challenged the constitutional validity of the Connecticut law. By a 7-2 decision, the U.S. Supreme Court declared the law unconstitutional. For those of you who are not students of U.S. constitutional law, the United States Supreme Court has 9 judges, and all 9 judges hear every single case, basically. So Justice Douglas in Griswold wrote the main opinion, and the majority, and he explained the rationale of the decision. And I quote, "Specific guarantees in the Bill of Rights have penumbras formed by emanations from those guarantees that help to give them life and substance. Various guarantees create zones of privacy. The present case then concerns a relationship lying within the zone of privacy created by several fundamental and constitutional guarantees." So in this case, this Supreme Court invented this doctrine of a zone of privacy. There's a zone of privacy, right? This is my home. This is my body, right? There's a zone of privacy. I have complete autonomy on what I choose to do with my body, right? It's a zone of privacy. And that autonomy, that right is granted to me by the Constitution of the United States, essentially, right? So, and I continue. Continue quoting Justice Douglas, "and it concerns a law which, in forbidding the use of contraceptives, rather than regulating their manufacture or sale, seeks to achieve its goals by means having a maximum destructive impact upon the relationship. Such a law cannot stand in light of the familiar principle so often applied by the Supreme Court that a governmental purpose," and this is very important, "a governmental purpose to control or prevent activities constitutionally subject to state regulation may not be achieved by means which sweep unnecessarily broadly and thereby invade the area of protected freedoms," right? So essentially, you would have a law, right? And you say, okay, how are we, what is the object of this law? Is the object of this law to prevent abortions? Is that the object of the law? Well, if that is the object of the law, the sweep is unnecessarily broad and its object itself is unconstitutional, they said, because you have right to use, right, a governmental purpose to control or prevent activities constitutionally subject to state regulation may not be achieved by means, right, which sweep unnecessarily broadly. They said, you have the power to pass a law regulating the manufacture or sale of contraceptives. And instead of regulating the manufacture or sale of contraceptives, what you're doing is you are punishing people who tell somebody, okay, there is this contraceptive, you can go buy it. You're not regulating manufacture or sale there. What you're regulating essentially is access to these contraceptives, and you want to punish people who essentially use these contraceptives because you believe that, you know, conception is natural and there should be no human impediment to conception. And here you're looking at a picture of Ms. Griswold standing in front of the Planned Parenthood clinic, a victorious Griswold at that. So then the landmark case of Roe v. Wade. In Roe v. Wade, the right of an unmarried pregnant woman to terminate her pregnancy by abortion was considered by the Supreme Court. The Texas law there, the woman was from the state of Texas, prohibited abortions except with respect to those procured or admitted by medical advice for the purpose of saving the life of the mother, right? So the United States simply said there, the law said in Texas that yes, you can get an abortion, but you can only get it when there's medical advice saying that the baby right, is threatening if the child is born, if the mother is allowed to have the child, it would essentially threaten the very life of the mother, right? So you need medical advice saying that an abortion is necessary for the purpose of saving the life of the mother. The constitutionality of this law was questioned on the ground that the said law improperly invaded the right and the choice of pregnant woman to terminate a pregnancy and violated her liberty which was guaranteed under the 14th Amendment to the Constitution and the right to privacy that was recognized in the case we've just discussed, Griswold, right? So essentially, what are the arguments in that case? It said we have a woman has a right to privacy with her body, right? And when you invade that private sphere, basically that was the argument made by Roe, right? Was that the argument made by that her was that you are essentially invading my right to abort this baby. I have a constitutionally recognized right to abortion was what she was arguing. Justice Blackmun delivered the majority opinion and he upheld the right to privacy. And I quote, the Constitution does not explicitly mention any right of privacy. In a line of decisions, however, this court has recognized that a right of personal privacy or a guarantee of certain areas or zones of privacy does exist under the Constitution. In varying contexts, the court or individual justices have indeed found at least the roots of that right in the First Amendment, in the penumbras of the Bill of Rights, in the Ninth Amendment, or in the concept of liberty guaranteed by the first section of the 14th Amendment. So essentially in Roe v. Wade, the Supreme Court upheld the right of a woman to get an abortion. It did not have to be just because her life was under threat if she were to have the child, right? So they recognized the right of a woman to have an abortion. It was a landmark decision that divided the United States back then and continues to divide the United States today. And pretty much the political battle lines are drawn around two issues in the United States today: your views on abortion and your views on gay rights, which we come to next. Here you're looking at a picture of the front page of the New York Times following the decision in Roe v. Wade, and you'll also see there the New York Times reporting the death of Lyndon B. Johnson, one of the former presidents of the United States. So coming to gay rights now. Lawrence v. Texas. In 2003, the Supreme Court in Lawrence v. Texas overturned an earlier ruling and found that Texas had violated the rights of two gay men when it enforced a law prohibiting sodomy. Justice Anthony Kennedy held that the petitioners were entitled to respect for their private lives. So here in India, for example, Section 377 has now been reinstated and has the Supreme Court has stated that it is constitutional. A similar law in Texas punished sodomy between two gay men, and this issue had to be considered by the Supreme Court in the context of the right to privacy. And Justice Anthony Kennedy held the state cannot demean their existence, the existence of gay men or homosexuals, or control their destiny by making their private sexual conduct a crime. Again, the right to privacy, the zone of privacy, right? You have a zone of privacy. What you do in the privacy of your own bedroom is your business and your business alone, and it's not the business of the state and the government, basically. And Lawrence v. Texas was a landmark ruling, and more recently, there has been a ruling on gay marriage in the United States, and the Supreme Court has held that gay marriage is federally mandated, it's constitutional, and all 50 states now have to recognize the legality of gay marriage, another landmark ruling and a big victory for the LGBT movement. The invasion of privacy by the press has also been considered in the United States, and it was referred to in Olmstead v. United States for the first time, but was fleshed out in Time Incorporated versus Hill. What happened in that case? Well, journalists, they said, in the United States, journalists are protected with the freedom of the press. The freedom of the press is an explicit right in the US, unlike in India, where freedom of the press has been read into Article 9's freedom of speech and expression, right? But in the US, it's an explicit right. So the freedom of the press is explicitly mentioned in the First Amendment of the US Constitution, while privacy rights of individuals, as we know, are not explicitly mentioned. So what happened in Time v. Hill? The case involved three escaped convicts. They're intruded into a house and held a family hostage for 19 hours. The whole ordeal sort of captured the imagination of the American nation. The incident was covered in local newspapers, and the members of the press started swarming the home for an account of what happened during this ordeal. The Hill family was unable to stop the siege of the press correspondents. They decided to relocate. Life magazine, a publication of Time Incorporated, sent its men to the former home of the family, where they reenacted the entire incident and photographed it demonstrating how members of the family were ill-treated by the intruders. So essentially, they did a reenactment. Those of you who watch TV shows, watch documentaries, will see a reenactment. You know, Crime Patrol in India, for example, which is a very popular show, wherein they reenact the scene of the crime. So they did the same thing in Time v. Hill. They reenacted it and portrayed the ordeal that the Hill family went through. When Life published the story, the family brought a suit against Time, right? Publishers of Life magazine, for invasion of their privacy and a violation of New York State's privacy law, right? They said, okay, you've published this story, you have invaded our privacy, right? And New York has a pretty stringent privacy law, and they brought a suit under that law, under that act, basically. So what was Hill's case? Hill accused Life of not fact-checking their article, which he claimed was inaccurate, as the intruders had treated the family well, whereas the article claimed that they had been subject to threats and abuse by the intruders. Essentially, they'd embellished the story, was what Hill was saying, and that violated the right to privacy. By a split decision, 5-4, the court found in favor of Time, holding that New York's privacy law could not be invoked without a fresh trial being held to determine whether Life had in fact reported the story, knowing it to be false, or had done so in a reckless disregard for the truth. What did they say? They said there needs to be a separate hearing, right? A court needs to determine whether Time actually published the story knowing it to be false and actually embellished the story knowing these, you know, additional ingredients that they added to be false. If it was actually false, then you invoke the privacy law. But you cannot automatically have recourse to the privacy law without proving fault on the part of Time. That is key. You have to prove actual fault on the part of Time magazine in publishing that story. If you cannot prove that fault, essentially, right, you cannot invoke the privacy law. So what did the Supreme Court say? The right to freedom of the press would trump the right to privacy in the absence of proof of falsity and fault. Right? Let me repeat that. Very important that you understand this. In the United States, the right to freedom of the press would trump the right to privacy in the absence of proof of falsity and fault. Right? Time v. Hill was an extension of another famous case in the United States, New York Times v. Sullivan, right, where the Supreme Court held it was incumbent upon public figures, celebrities claiming to be defamed by the press, to prove actual malice on behalf of the publisher. Very high, stringent standard. You have to show actual malice that, you know, they actually were out to get you, right? So they publish a story about Kanye West and Kim Kardashian, right? In the United States, you have to actually prove actual malice, that they did so with malice. Right? Intent. Very hard to prove intent, right? A successful claim for defamation is very unlikely, therefore, for public figures in the United States. But they do have the right to publicity, which is a part of the right to privacy. So basically, the US says, look, you are benefiting from being famous, essentially. You've put yourself in the public eye. So you have to accept a certain amount of coverage, a certain amount of invasion of your privacy. But at the same time, when it comes to commercial issues, your right to publicity, we will protect you. Right? You have built up your own image, you have built up a name for yourself, and nobody should be allowed to appropriate that name or likeness, basically. This was directly an issue in the case of Jackie Onassis, who was the widow of Jackie Kennedy, and she married the Greek millionaire Onassis, ergo the name Jackie Onassis. So Jackie Onassis, or Jackie O, as she was known as, brought a case against Christian Dior, right? The defendant Christian Dior used a model that was a lookalike of Jackie O in an advertisement. Finding in Jackie O's favor, the court reiterated that public figures have the right to control commercial exploitation of their name and likeness, right? Public figures have the right to control commercial exploitation of their name and likeness. As far as the right to publicity is concerned, there is no conflict between the freedom of the press and the privacy rights of individuals, right? If the press is trying to make money out of a celebrity's name, right? If a company like Christian Dior is trying to make money out of, you know, Jackie Kennedy or Jackie Onassis' image, right? There is no such conflict between the freedom of the press. This picture will help you understand, right? So this picture started appearing in magazines and newspapers. Christian Dior was placing these adverts. This model looked like Jackie Kennedy, Jackie Onassis. She dressed like Jackie Onassis in the adverts. Her hair was done like Jackie Onassis, right? Essentially, Christian Dior is giving the impression that, oh, Jackie Onassis is actually endorsing Christian Dior, when in fact Jackie O was doing no such thing, and they were unlawfully benefiting and appropriating her name and likeness. Therefore, she had a right to publicity and she could sue Christian Dior. Now we come to the Privacy Act 1974 in the United States. Privacy Act in the United States guarantees three primary rights, and the Privacy Act essentially just deals with the use of records held by the government, right? It provides safeguards against invasion of personal privacy through the misuse of records by federal agencies. Now let's come to the right of privacy, right to privacy in the United Kingdom. First of all, is there such a thing as a right to privacy in the United Kingdom? Considered in Wainwright v. Home Office, the court found a great difference between identifying privacy as a value which underlies the existence of a rule of law, right, and privacy as a principle of law in itself. Very, very fine distinction. They say, okay, we recognize that privacy is an important normative value. We recognize privacy is an important value. We do. But is it a constitutionally recognized right? That's a different issue, right? You might have elements of privacy when it comes to freedom of expression, for example, right? But is it an explicit right? It's not, is what the court held, the House of Lords held in Wainwright v. Home Office. The English common law, judge-made law, that is, familiar with the notion of underlying values, principles only in the broadest sense which direct its development, right? The principle of the right to privacy does exist, right? It only the undervalue privacy or value of such privacy that exists. Let me just repeat that. The courts in the UK have said, yes, we recognize the principle of privacy, but we don't recognize the right to privacy. It's per se. And so, does that mean that all information about your private life, for example, can be used? Well, the answer is no, because of something known as a doctrine of confidence in the United Kingdom. The right to privacy in the UK has developed mostly through the doctrine of confidence. In the case of Coco versus A.N. Clark, the court identified three essential elements which must be proved to show that there has been a breach of confidence, right? There have to be three elements that have to be proved. What are those three elements that show that, yes, this is information protected by confidence, confidential information. You, in disclosing this information, have breached this confidence, and that's a invasion of privacy. First, the information must have the necessary quality of confidence about it. This means that the information must be secret or confidential, right? Second, the information must have been imparted in circumstances importing an obligation of confidence. And third, there must be an unauthorized use of the information to the detriment of the party communicating it. So, classic example of this is privileged information. You go and see a psychiatrist, you tell that psychiatrist the deepest and darkest details and truths about your life, and that psychiatrist promptly goes to the press because you're, let's say, a famous person, you're a celebrity, and discloses everything you said in that counseling session. That is a, you know, rock solid, stone cold breach of the duty of a breach of confidence, basically, and that's an invasion of privacy, right? Now, Lord Gough of the House of Lords in AG Attorney General versus a Guardian newspapers laid out the situations when this confidence, breach of confidence, duty of confidence, this doctrine of confidence does not apply, right? So when does the doctrine of confidence not apply? Okay. Once information enters what is usually called the public domain, which means merely that the information in question is so generally accessible that in all the circumstances, it cannot be regarded as confidential, then as a general rule, the principle of confidentiality can have no application to it. So let us say Britney Spears writes an article saying that she's bipolar. Tomorrow, a newspaper carries that story and says that Britney Spears is bipolar, right, in the United Kingdom, right? That newspaper in the United Kingdom say, carrying the story that Britney Spears is bipolar is only carrying information which is in the public domain, put in the public domain by Britney Spears herself in this case, for example, right? So the duty of confidence does not apply there because this information is so generally easily accessible, right? Then there's also the duty of confidence does not apply to useless information. It does not apply to information that has absolutely no value. Somebody says that Britney Spears has blonde hair. That's useless information, really. I mean, and that's not, you know, confidence cannot apply to that information. So Britney Spears sees a counselor and the counselor goes to the press and says, did you see Britney Spears? And he says, yes, I saw Britney Spears. What's the color of her hair right now? And say, well, the color of Britney Spears' hair, well, it's blonde. It's useless information. So you can't really say there's a breach of confidence. Maybe there is at some level, but the doctrine of confidence, a legal standard, is not violated, right? And the right to confidence may be outweighed also by some countervailing public interest which favors disclosure, right? So there might be a public interest right? Knowing, okay, why? There must be a public interest which favors disclosure. A couple of years ago in the United Kingdom, there was a case of a famous footballer who had had an affair with his brother's wife. And he went all guns blazing, did everything he could to ensure that that information did not enter the public domain. And he was successful to a large extent. Now, there, that involved the case of a footballer. But what if it is the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom? Could there be a public interest which favors disclosure? Perhaps. You know, in France, for example, privacy laws are very, very stringent. And you have the current President Francois Hollande, a lot of his popular marital problems were publicized more in the non-French media than the French media itself. Because probably in the United Kingdom, for example, where it was a big story, Francois Hollande had an extramarital affair, for example, it was a very big story. But the French public said, well, that's his private life. There's no public interest. So again, public interest is very contextual. It's about the public interest in the society in which that information is being disclosed. In the UK, sometimes you would probably say, knowing British culture, information about the Prime Minister's private life might actually be considered something that has a public interest value. Now, coming to Article 8 ECHR, that's the European Convention on Human Rights. Any discussion on the right to privacy in the United Kingdom is incomplete without considering Article 8, which simply states that everyone has the right to respect for his private and family life, his home and his correspondence. Again, in Article 8, you see this conflict between the common law culture in England and the more civil law culture that you have in France. Sort of you have the English approach and the French approach to law, which is diametrically opposed to one another. These conflicts, these pushes and these pulls and tensions are reflected in the ECHR as well. Article 8 says there shall be no interference by public authority with the exercise of this right except such as is in accordance with the law and is necessary in a democratic society in the interest of national security, public safety or the economic well-being of the country, for the prevention of disorder or crime, for the protection of health or morals, or for the protection of the rights and freedoms of others, right? So they also speak of public authority. Public authority should not, government essentially should not interfere in this privacy, right to privacy. However, that's not an absolute right. Exceptional scenarios wherein it is in the interest of national security, the economic well-being of the country, prevention of disorder or crime, places like countries like Greece come to mind, protection of health or morals over the protection of the rights and freedom of others, basically. So it's not an absolute bar under the ECHR. Now, how does Article 8 ECHR apply to the United Kingdom? Some understanding of the European Union is necessary. Once a country enters the European Union, it submits itself to the jurisdiction of the International, the European Court of Human Rights, which is tasked with interpreting and applying the provisions of the European Convention on Human Rights. Therefore, in the United Kingdom, the final court, which used to be the House of Lords, now known as the Supreme Court, is no longer the Supreme Court. The final court of appeal, the highest court of the land in the UK, is not in the land, it's in Strasbourg. That's the European Court of Human Rights, basically. Right? So, let's look at some of the interplay between Article 8 and the British law, and where the interplay between privacy in England, the United Kingdom, and Article 8. Now let's look at the notorious case of Campbell versus MGN. The Campbell being Naomi Campbell, the supermodel. In Campbell v. MGN, the House of Lords by a majority of 3-2 took the view that the details of Ms. Campbell's treatment with Narcotics Anonymous together with the photographs constituted private information, the publication of which amounted to what used to be called a breach of confidence. According to Lord Nicholls, the essence of the breach of confidence was better encapsulated as a misuse of private information. See, essentially here, there is no nature of the information between the newspaper and Naomi Campbell. The relationship between the newspaper and Naomi Campbell isn't one of confidence. They don't owe a duty to Naomi Campbell. There's no fiduciary duty. The information has not been exchanged between them. They've obtained, basically, a picture of Naomi Campbell coming out of a Narcotics Anonymous meeting. Basically, right, they've obtained that information. So that's private information. The fact that Naomi Campbell is in rehab for drug addiction is private information. And then you splash this across the front page of your newspaper, right? And you can see a photo of that in front of you, basically. So there, they considered this and they said that that is an invasion of privacy. It's a misuse of private information, basically. So, students, that brings us to the end of this module. This module has dealt with the complexities of the right to privacy in the US and the UK. Neither jurisdiction, as we've seen, has explicitly recognized this right to privacy in a written document, in a form of statute, case law, or the Constitution, as is the case in the United States. The courts have therefore had to step in. It's essentially been judge-made law that has helped the right to privacy grow and evolve. And they've developed it on a case-by-case basis. In the US, four classes, as we've seen, of privacy rights have emerged, with only one class, the right to publicity, being universally recognized. In the UK, the courts continue to maintain that there is no explicit right to privacy, a position that is certainly suspect, given the precedence according to Article 8 in the UK. Article 8 clearly says there's a right to privacy, so one has to assume that now the time has come for the UK to shed whatever notions it has that no, there is no right to privacy, and it probably has to embrace Article 8 of the ECHR, which guarantees the right to privacy. This module has demonstrated also how this right to privacy has played a key role in some of the more controversial spheres of life in the US, such as abortion, gay rights, and birth control. One can conclude that the value underlying the right to privacy is essentially that each person has an innate right to keep private information private, subject to certain narrowly defined exceptions, is recognized by both the United States and the United Kingdom.